Allah in the Quran did not talk exhaustively about marriage. Like, He didn't describe all the things that make a marriage work. There are very few places in the Quran where Allah gave us some insights, and basically it's like, instead of describing the entire building, He mentioned a few pillars. If those pillars are not there, the building's gonna collapse, right? And one of those pillars is that the money responsibility is the man's responsibility. He better go find a job, he better go get some work, he better go and provide, because that is actually what Allah has made him responsible for. The word qawwam in the beginning is now being explained by the fact that men are financially responsible for the groceries, for the car, for the fuel, for the electricity bill, for the school, you know, school supplies for the kids, everything. Everything. And that starts from the very beginning. When you get married, you take the responsibility of paying a mahr, a dowry, right? And some people, they love to have a high number for the dowry for their daughter. They say it's going to be 100,000 or 50,000 or 250,000 or whatever. They put this crazy number. And they're like, no, it's okay. You don't have to pay it now. It's okay. But mashallah, we should have a number that looks good. And then people are married for 20 years and the guy hasn't paid his dowry. That's ridiculous. Because this is a condition of making a marriage valid. You can't put that off. You can't just keep kicking the can down the road. And a husband isn't even allowed to say to his wife, hey, by the way, can you give me a discount? I know you put 50, can we take a few zeros off of that? Or how about I give it to you, not dollars, can I give it to you in rupees? Same number, you know. You know, I'll give you in, you know, Zimbabwean currency or something. I'll give you some other currency that, you know, because, you know, come on, just go easy. I have a hard life, look at all the things I'm doing. Can you just go, if you agreed to it, then you signed on. If you didn't want to agree to it, then you should never signed that document. You're actually not even allowed to hint that you have trouble paying your mahr. Men aren't even allowed to hint at that. فَإِن طِبْنَ لَكُمْ عَن نَفْسٍ مِّنْهُ شَيْئًا. And after you pay the dowry, like if you're a monthly payments you're making, you give her like $500 or something, 100 bucks, whatever you give her, that's part of your dowry that you're paying off. And you pay her and you're like, fine, here's your monthly. You know, this week was really tough. This month was... You can't make none of those comments. And if she takes those $100 from you, and then she takes out a dollar bill and says, here, go get yourself some ice cream. If she does that, then, and you say, okay, thanks, you can take that if she did it on her own. But once you're handing that money, you're not even looking at that money anymore. It ain't yours. That's part of being a man, according to the Quran. It's part of being رجال قوامون على النساء. So you know when, and the reason I was kind of, one of the reasons I was pushed to give this lecture is because lots of people email me all kinds of questions, and there are many men around the world whose wives are being told to go get a job and work while they're sitting at home. Muslim men. And they're saying, you have to obey your husband. What kind of ridiculous, what religion is that? Allah Azza wa Jal made men responsible financially. And they can't even say, you have to go and we're having a hard time, you need to earn this or that. Look, if there's a desperate situation and a wife decides to go get a job and support financially or do on her own, that's a voluntary thing she's doing that she cannot be told to do. And if she does that, if she does get a job, if she does have a business, if her father left behind some stores or some property in her name, and you're like, hey, can we get some of that too? Because I'm your family. No, that's her money. You can't touch it. Allah made this equation in which she has a financial advantage, meaning your money is basically hers. And her money is hers. And you can't look at it. You can't keep your eye on it. You can't say, whatever happened to that? What happened to that jewelry? What happened to that? No, that's not yours to touch. That's not yours to touch. And whatever you gave her, like you say, hey, you know, on our 10th anniversary, I'm going to give you this car. Then you know, once you gave her the car, it's her car. It's her. You can't even take the keys and say, I'm going. No, you got to get her permission. And she better give it on her own good free will. No pressure, not even unspoken pressure that you could touch that car. Because you gave it up, it's done. It's done. وَآتُ النِّسَاءَ صَدُقَاتِهِنَّ نِحْلَةً. Give women their gifts happily and freely. Don't even think about them again. Don't even think about them again. So this financial sense that men are supposed to have is critical. And Allah mentions that as one of the first conditions of what makes a marriage work. What makes them men? الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم. When they take that kind of responsibility, where the wife doesn't have to ask, hey, we don't have food for groceries, we don't have money for groceries, we don't have this. Oh, I gotta give you again? You know, and for a lot of men, you know what they do? They feel that they owe financial responsibility or financial help to their brother, okay, to their sister, to their mother and their father, who may be financially already taken care of, but you still want to give them, but you're not giving financial needs to your wife and your children. That's not being a man. That's not being a man. And some people are in financial abuse situations where I've even seen cases where the bank account is a joint account between the husband, the man, and his mother. And the wife has no access to the account. What Islam did you learn? Where did you get this from? And the wife is being constantly told, by the way, that's our son. It's like, that's our property, you're just renting it. You know? This is what the wife is being told. If you wanted to act that way, then you had no business getting married. If you wanted to financially treat the spouse this way, then you have no business being in the institution of marriage. This is the first and foremost principle. You know, there are people who give mahar, they give marriage gifts, or even at the wedding ceremony, they give lots of presents, and then a couple of days later, the guy's family says, hey, can we have those back? We need them for our daughter's wedding. Once you give it up, you've given it up. It's done with. Now let's flip to the other. And the sisters that are listening to this right now are like, yeah, finally a khutbah about team ladies. Well, you know, I told you in the beginning, Allah is fair. There's a balanced equation. Allah loves both sides, men and women. Allah told the men what responsibilities they have. The rest of this, the khutbah, is actually the other side. So men are responsible for all of this, and they better, you know, drip their sweat and break their backs earning for a family and go through all of the labor that they need to go through to take care of them and provide for them and protect them and take care of them emotionally and financially and physically and all of those things. Well, what do the women owe then?